We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Let us pray. Almighty God, we pray you graciously to behold this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up, and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so marred was his appearance beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of mortals. So he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which had not been told them, they shall see, and that which they had not heard, they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity. And as one from whom others hid their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice, he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him, the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish, he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Hebrews. The Holy Spirit testifies, saying, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds." He also adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more." Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Sing my tongue, the glorious God, and all of my sin, God, fix me. Tell the child, Father, have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me to you has the greater sin. When behold your mother.
Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. I was a teenager when the film The Passion of the Christ came out. At the time, I was attending an evangelical church in Southern California. It's hard to underestimate or understate what an impact this film made in evangelical communities. It was like evangelical Christians had suddenly rediscovered Holy Week. There were trips to movie theaters for people to see it together. There were exceptions made for younger kids to see this R-rated movie with its graphic depictions of the crucifixion of Christ. There was even a sense that you weren't really a Christian until you had seen the film, or at least that's what it felt like to my adolescent self. Watching The Passion of the Christ was a rite of passage akin to baptism. It was a mature statement of faith that you were ready to witness Christ's suffering in its most exaggerated, uncensored form. The Passion of the Christ, for those who don't know, is a 2004 film produced by Mel Gibson, himself a controversial figure and a devout Catholic. The film itself was also controversial. It depicts the last 12 hours of Jesus' life in the most graphic terms, with an emphasis on the physical suffering that Jesus experienced. Some have criticized the film's graphic nature. Others have noted the film's failure to address lingering Semitism in the narrative, in particular, in implications that the Jewish people were singularly responsible for Jesus' death, an understanding that is false and harmful. Despite these controversies, the film was heartily endorsed and embraced by Christians in the community that I knew well, and I felt that in a personal way, as a young adult who thought that I had to witness unblinking the suffering of Jesus in order to be saved. The Passion of the Christ, as a film, reveals a piece of theology that was central to my evangelical upbringing, the idea that Jesus not only had to die for our sins, but that he had to suffer in the most heinous way. I remember listening to several sermons where the preacher insisted that crucifixion was the most painful way to die, as if Jesus' suffering was only worthwhile if it surpassed everyone else's suffering by miles. The preachers persisted in this claim, ignoring the fact that two other prisoners were crucified right alongside Jesus. They ignored or simply didn't know that the crucifixion was a common form of capital punishment under the Roman Empire. I'm sure that teenagers in my youth group, imaginative and strange as teenagers can be, could have come up with some other forms of death that sound more gruesome and painful. Nevertheless, it was of the utmost importance to the spiritual leaders in that church to say that Jesus' death was the worst. No matter what happens to us, no matter what pain or suffering we experience, Jesus had it worst of all. Now, I don't mean to downplay the suffering of Jesus on the cross, certainly not on this day of all days, Good Friday. However, I do hope that we can see ourselves more clearly on this day when we contemplate Jesus' death on the cross and what it means for us. More specifically, I hope we can see the ways that we, as human beings, glorify pain. The Passion of the Christ is a prime example of our tendency to glorify pain. In some strains of Christian belief, we have located the power of Christ entirely in his suffering, instead of locating the power of Christ in his love and his teachings. When we overemphasize the physical suffering of Christ, we forget the importance of his emotional and spiritual suffering. When we overemphasize the physical suffering of Christ, we downplay the significance of Christ's life and teaching. When we overemphasize the physical suffering of Christ, we imply that our own lives are not worthy or virtuous unless we suffer like Christ too. We run the risk of measuring our lives in terms of pain instead of measuring our lives in terms of grace and love. There's a term I've heard used for this competitive glorification of pain. I've heard it called the Suffering Olympics. At times, we act as if we are in constant competition to prove who suffers worse than others, as if pain itself is something that should give us worth or power or voice. This happens on a big picture level, such as when people consider consciously or subconsciously whether one group of people has faced more suffering than another because of historic and systemic wrongs. On a sociological level, this is sometimes called the Oppression Olympics, a related term with a history all of its own. However, we participate in the Suffering Olympics on a personal level, too. We participate in these Suffering Olympics whenever someone you know has a particularly difficult week and you respond by saying, "Oh, wait until you hear about mine," and then proceed to talk all about your experiences instead of listening to someone else's. We participate in the Suffering Olympics when we tell our children that they have things way better than we did in our day, rather than trying to understand their unique stories and their unique struggles. We participate in the Suffering Olympics even when we write our own pain off, perhaps saying that we shouldn't feel bad for ourselves when bad things happen, because at least we aren't experiencing this or that or the other thing. In each of these cases, we place a value judgment on our lives based on how much we have or have not experienced pain. In a bizarre, mixed-up way, we glorify that pain, just as Christians so often fall into that trap of glorifying Jesus' pain on the cross. One particularly tragic example of how human beings participate in this suffering Olympics is present in our news almost every day, as we hear ongoing coverage of the war between the State of Israel and Hamas. In an October 2023 article by Tarunjit Singh Bhutalia, published by the Religion News Service, Bhutalia addresses this problem of the Olympics of suffering in relation to the conflict in Israel and Palestine. He describes being in settings where the suffering of Israelis is described in graphic detail without any mention of the suffering of Palestinians. Conversely, he describes settings in which Palestinian suffering is at the forefront without any mention of the suffering of Israelis. Bhutalia writes, "The message to me was clear. The pain of my religious community is so immense that I don't want to hear the pain of the other side in the same breath at this time." Bhutalia suggests that we have to move beyond this Olympics of suffering in order to pursue any kind of meaningful peace. He writes, quote, "Recognition of the pain of the other does not mean you agree with its causes. We need this empathy to recognize that both communities are in pain without arguing over the magnitude of suffering on each side. This is compassion, at least a fundamental value in every religious tradition in the world. And lastly, we are only as secure as the least among us. May we live up to these ideals." End quote. Bhutalia shares these thoughts as a U.S. Sikh interfaith activist, but they are ideas that resonate deeply with me as a Christian because they remind me of the teachings of Jesus Christ. God does not love us on a graduated scale based on how much suffering we have experienced. Instead, God loves each and every one of us completely and joins us completely in our joy and in our pain. Jesus, in his ministry, validated the experiences of people from different backgrounds and stations in society. He empathized deeply with both marginalized Samaritans and Roman centurions at the heart of the empire, with tax collectors and those living on the edge of poverty. And somehow Jesus did this all while encouraging us to always look out for the least among us. The fact that Jesus prioritized the least of these in his teaching and ministry does not mean that Jesus made a hierarchy of our sufferings. It simply means that Jesus understood and also avidly taught that we are all interconnected. Whatever happens to the least one of us impacts us all. And so we should be moved by other people's pain, whether or not their suffering is deemed greater or lesser than ours. We can commit to following Jesus by practicing empathy and compassion, feeling pain when others are in pain, and feeling joy when others are joyful. That is exactly what God did when Jesus was born into this world. God perfected empathy by becoming human to live, love, and die among us. Tonight, I want you to hear this. The power of Jesus' sacrifice has nothing to do with how much or how little Jesus suffered during his death on the cross. Instead, the power of Jesus' sacrifice has everything to do with the fact that God became human. God subjected God's own self not only to the particular suffering of Jesus on the cross, but also to the suffering and joy of every human being in the past, the present, and even the future. When you look at the cross, whose suffering do you see? I hope you see the suffering of Jesus Christ. And I hope you also see the suffering of thousands of Palestinians who are starving in Gaza, experiencing the near constant threat of bombing. I hope you see the suffering of the Israeli hostages, their families and communities, and those who died in the October 7th attack. I hope you imagine the suffering of someone unknown to me whose pain is deeply known and cared for by you. And I hope you can see your own struggle, too, when you look at the cross, trusting that God joins you in the midst of your pain, no matter how great or how small it may seem. God loves us all, grieves with us all, and celebrates with us all when there is good to be shared in this world. The cross shatters our human hierarchies of pain and invites us into a selfless, endlessly interconnected love. May our adoration of the cross on this night expand our hearts to love as Jesus loved. For that is the way of the cross. That is the way of our salvation. Amen.
Dear people of God, Atatoa Tokmamba sent his son into the world to condemn the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world through him may be saved, that all who believe in him may be delivered from the power of sin and death and become heirs with him of everlasting life. We pray, therefore, for people everywhere according to their needs.
Let us pray. Let us pray for the Holy Catholic Church of Christ throughout the world, for its unity in witness and service, for all bishops and all ministries and the people whom they serve, for Michael, our presiding bishop, for Jeff and Laura, our bishops, for Luke, Heidi, and Peter, our priest, for Kyle, our deacon, for Deacon Jeremy, Samantha, and Will, our seminarians, and all the people of this diocese, for all Christians in this community, for those about to be baptized, that God will confirm God's church in faith, increase it in love, and preserve it in peace.
Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray for all nations and peoples of the earth and for those in authority among them, for Joseph, our president, for Ned, our governor, for the Congress and the Supreme Court, for the members and representatives of the United Nations, for all who serve the common good, that by God's help they may seek justice and truth and live in peace and comfort.
Almighty God, kindle, we pray, in every heart the true love of peace, and guide with your wisdom those who take counsel for the nations of the earth, that in tranquility your dominion may increase until the earth is filled with the knowledge of your love through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for all who suffer and are afflicted in body or in mind. For the hungry and the homeless, the destitute and the oppressed. For those who are sick, wounded, and disabled. For those in loneliness, fear, and anguish. For those who face temptation, doubt, and despair. For the sorrowful and bereaved. For prisoners and captives and those in mortal danger. For those who suffer from addiction. That God, in God's mercy, will comfort and relieve them, and grant them the knowledge of God's love, and stir up in us the will and patience to minister to their needs.
Gracious God, the comfort of all who sorrow, the strength of all who suffer, let the cry of those in misery and need come to you, that they may find your mercy present with them in all their afflictions. And give us, we pray, the strength to serve them for the sake of him who suffered for us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray for all who have not received the gospel of Christ, for those who have never heard the word of salvation, for those who have lost their faith, for those hardened by sin or indifference, for the contemptuous and the scornful, for those who persecute Christ's disciples, for those who in the name of Christ have persecuted others, that God will open their hearts to the truth and lead them to faith and obedience.
Merciful God, creator of all the peoples of the earth and lover of souls, have compassion on all who do not know you as you are revealed in your Son, Jesus Christ. Let your gospel be preached with grace and power to those who have not heard it. Turn the hearts of those who resist it, and bring home to your fold those who have gone astray, that there may be a one flock under one shepherd, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Let us commit ourselves to our God and pray for the grace of a holy life, that with all who have departed this world and have died in the peace of Christ, and those whose faith is known to God alone, we may be accounted worthy to enter into the fullness of the joy of our Lord and receive the crown of life in the day of resurrection.
O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, that things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Behold the wood of the cross, whereon was hung the world's salvation.
O come, let us worship.
Behold the wood of the cross, whereon was hung the world's salvation.
O come, let us worship.
Behold the wood of the cross, whereon was hung the world's salvation.
O come, let us worship.
bow down before the Lord. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, we pray you to set your passion, cross, and death between your judgment and our souls, now and in the hour of our death. Give mercy and grace to the living, pardon and rest to the dead, to your holy church, peace and concord, and to us sinners everlasting life and glory. For with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, one God, now and forever. Amen.